Okay, so today we're going to be replacing the screen on a MacBook Air. So the last time I did a video of replacing the screen on a MacBook Air, it was a really poor quality video. The reason it was a poor quality video is because that was the first MacBook Air screen replacement that I had ever done. So that was not designed to be the best MacBook Air screen replacement video. I did that video after seeing a bunch of posts on this iFixit thread saying, it's impossible, you have to replace the assembly. And I had an employee on vacation that week. So the whole idea of that wasn't necessarily to make the best video of how to do it. It was rather to make the point that for this thing that everybody's saying is impossible, not only can I do it on the first time, but an idiot business owner, not even the proper technician, the idiot business owner will do it right in the first time. The problem is that I see a lot of people commenting on that video, a lot of people using that video, and they think that that's actually how they should fix it. And the thing is, that was a terrible video, god-awful video. It was great at the time back before a lot of people knew how to do it, but yeah, it's 2016 now. I'm sure a lot of other people have done videos on how to do it properly, so I'm going to go over that here. So the first thing I do is I use this little JBC hot air station, and what I'm going to do is lower it to a temperature. I don't have to worry about melting the rubber here, so I'm going to go, you know, 175 Celsius and low air. I'm just going to go around it a little bit. Now, the thing is, let me just lower the air a little more here. I'm not looking to really do much other than warm it up, like a just really basic warm-up. I'm not looking to actually melt the adhesive with this. You're going to see how I plan on melting the adhesive in a second. Just going to go over this. And I plan on being interrupted multiple times over the course of this video. Just going to go around the MacBook Air here. Going around it, around it, around it. And I'll notice how I am a little faster when I go around the webcam or I dip because I don't feel like burning the webcam. It would be really stupid to burn the webcam, particularly if you're using a heat gun or something where you can't really adjust temperature. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put this to the maximum temperature it goes to, which is 450 Celsius, really hot. And I'm not going to use that on the computer. I'm going to use that on this little tool here. This is one of these... It's the little Utrecht art supply store spatulas. The code on it is 03117-1019. So I'll put that up here. I'll get my face out of the way so the camera goes off face focus and tries to focus on what's in front of it. Who are we kidding? That's not happening. So I'll just turn on manual focus for a second here so that you can see exactly what that skew looks like. That's about as good as that's going to get. So now we go back to the regular focus. So what I'm going to do now, I don't heat the bezel. Because again, this is how people start burning the rubber trim. They're heating around there, and they're not paying attention, or they forget something, and that's how this gets screwed up. So I have this tool inside the nozzle of the JBC. It's shooting 450 Celsius air into this at a really high airflow. And I'm just going to burn this thing to hell. So I'm putting a lot of hot air on this. I'm going to make sure that this thing is like a little burning little rod. So now what I do is I am going to... Here. I usually do this on my lap, but I can't do it on my lap because if I do it on my lap, you won't be able to see it. So now what I'm going to do here, and the reason I put the camera a little close to me is so that I can zoom in so that you can actually see up close what I'm doing with it. That's just... Sorry for all this shaking. So anyway, so I'm just going to go back to this, make sure this is nice and hot, I'm gonna turn off the face focus on the camera because there's no need for face focus right now. All right. So I'm just going to go make sure this is nice and hot, freshly hot. This and watch. It's going to cut through the adhesive very nicely. Well, it's not going to cut through it nicely because I'm trying to record it cutting through nicely. See what it does? Also, don't touch the metal right now. Remember, I heated that metal to 450 Celsius. That would be pretty fucking stupid to touch that. So I'm just, see how it's cutting right through? Just move this keyboard out of the way so I can get this in. I love how the camera's trying to focus more on the keyboard in front of the MacBook Air than it is focusing on the MacBook Air. It's going to go like this. I'm going to go right around. I'm keeping my MacBook on top of this nice thick paper towel that I have here so that it doesn't get scratched. Remember, I usually do this on my lap, and I do it with the machine, I usually do it with the machine like this, so I don't have to worry about any of that. But again, you're not going to be able to see anything in a video if I try and record that way, so I'm doing it on my desk. But I would advise not doing this on the desk because it's a great way to scratch the back of the machine. And if you scratch the back of the machine, people will scream bloody murder. All right, so now, probably going to go to manual focus because the camera's tripping. Let's see, here we go. Manual focus here. Focus on what I want you to focus on. There we go. It's not following. Now, once I get to the point to here, see how I'm lifting up a little? I usually don't lift up because I don't want to risk bending the bezel. However, I'd rather risk bending the bezel over there than destroying the camera. It's very easy to knock off those little SMD components in the camera. So I keep going. I'm touching it by the metal now because it's kind of cooled off a little bit, so it's not burning me. And I have so many calluses on my hand at this point, just from doing this stuff for all these years of my life, that I honestly can't even... I don't even feel when I'm getting burned anymore half the time. So, I'm going to go over here, and we're going to continue down. Now I'm feeling that I'm hitting a little bit more resistance. Because it cooled down, but whatever, I'm good. Okay, now we're doing the bottom. This is going to be hard to get on camera because I usually do it like this and I pull, which means I have to be a lefty. Oh, that sucks. No offense on you if you are a lefty, but I'm not, so this is going to be bullshit. Yeah, this is some bullshit. If I'm going to be a lefty, I need some more heat. So we take this again. Nice and out of focus. Great video. Great quality of video production, asshole. Great quality. Now 50,000 people get to see that I don't know how to use a fucking camera. All right. 50,000 subscribers. That's insane. Sometime around December of 2015, I got to a point where I was gaining 150 to 220 subscribers a day, and that's just unreal. All right, so here it looks like we're just gonna... Okay, so let me just wiggle this a little bit. It got cold since I just had to go help somebody, so I'm just gonna heat this up a little bit. Gonna heat it up. Gonna try and fuck with the focus here. All right, now we heat it. Great. Now you have a perfect in-focus view of what it looks like as I'm heating the spatula, which is totally worthless effort that I could have applied to something else. So now, come on, turn the focus back, idiot. There we go. We're going to go back. What fun. Also, one thing to note here. See the spatula? You don't want to bend it. You don't want to yaw it to the left like that while it's under the bezel. Because if you do that, you wind up bending the bezel unnaturally. And that is going to just cause all sorts of nightmares in hell. So I'll do a tiny bit of it here so you can see what I'm talking about, but not enough to actually bend the bezel permanently. This is another part of the game. This is another part of this shitty early 1980s crappy ET-like game. This is not like the bezel to a Lenovo where if it bends, it bends back. This is not like a bezel to any other reasonably designed laptop over the course, of the last 10 or 20 years. This is a fucked up game that Apple plays. If that bezel bends even the tiniest bit, it will be permanently bent in a manner where it will never go back properly, no matter what glue you use, no matter what tape you use, no matter how hard you press. So be very, very careful with this. And trust me, they'll notice. They'll notice if it's bent anywhere, especially at the bottom, they will notice. So be very careful with this. Just going to keep walking our way through. Okay, a little bit more heat. This section over here is the biggest pain in the ass, the bottom right corner, where you started. This part sucks. It just sucks. There's not much I can say about it. Hey. Here we go. We're just about to the end. Come on. Fuck you. Come off. Come off. Come off, you piece of shit. Here we go. There we go. The bezel. Bam. It's off. And we put this aside for now. And here's the part where you get to realize that I unplugged my microphone for a short period of time, so I'm overdubbing. Yep, you just caught me. You just caught me. You saw my lips moving and you didn't hear anything. So this is the part that really sucks. This is the other part of this shitty game. So I want you to take a look at this. You may think there's only two screws over here, right? There's not. There's seven. You know why you can't see them? Because Apple decided to cover the screws with black fucking tape. Yes, they decided to cover a piece that you need to remove to fix this properly with black tape. That looks like just, you know, nothing's there, right? There's nothing there. No, there's a fucking Phillips screw behind there. This is bullshit. This is one of, again, of all, when I criticize Apple construction, the way Apple puts together these products, there's a reason for it. There's no fucking point to a piece of black tape being there. There is no engineering, no design reason, no longevity reason, no repairability reason that does, it serves no fucking purpose. So what I do up here is I use the magnets to hold the screw. Don't put them down on the table. It's an easy way to lose them. If you're doing this at home and you don't have a set of magnets, put them on the top, right where that set of magnets is on the top. It'll make life easy for you. Remember where all your screws go. And this is a big issue. You know, again, when it comes to things like this, it's not as big an issue as it is with, let's say, the iPhone. With the iPhone 4 CDMA and the 4S, oh my God, you have a board that is dark in color. And in the corner of it, you cover the screw that's holding the board in place in the foam with a piece of black fucking tape. How many people out there in the world managed to destroy an iPhone 4 because they didn't notice that there was a screw that was covered under tape? Every screw in that machine, in that entire phone, is not covered with tape except for the one fucking screw that is covered with tape. So people were probably trying to lift the board out of the phone. They thought it was stuck. They ripped and they pulled and they destroyed it. All because of this stupid shit. It's bullshit. It's fucking bullshit. And now we return to the part before I overdubbed.
When it comes to things like, let's say, the iPhone, you know, how...
So, now, more of this hidden shit. See this over here? It's like an optical fucking illusion. So, we have this little black piece of tape on this black PC board, and that's going to a cable behind it. And that's a cable that's really easy to rip. And you know what happens if you rip the cable? You have to replace the backlight. You know what happens when people replace the backlight? They fuck up the layers, and it doesn't look the same. Again, think of this like a really shitty video game. I want you to think of this like one of those really crappy video games from the early 80s, where, you know, not the good stuff like Mario. I mean, like the really shit games where, you know, you're supposed to, like, dive into a pit and then, like, try to make your way up from the pit, but you keep falling if you're, like, one pixel away from where you're supposed to be. There was this game, I think it was E.T. or something like that. It was one of the worst games of all time where you have to try to make your way up from a pit. Repairing Apple products is very much so like those video games. So you got this. See this? The tape? Okay, I fucked up a little. I removed some of the covering on this PC board. But this PC board goes to a screen that I'm throwing away anyway, so fuck that. So I'm also to make life easy, I'm just gonna cut this off. Now, because again, I don't care about this PC board. This PC board is worthless to me. What I care about is that little cable behind it. So first thing I'm gonna do over here is I am going to disconnect the LCD cable So this over here is the display EDP DisplayPort cable that's connecting the screen to the computer. We're going to disconnect that. Also, note, I didn't unplug the battery for this. There's a big idea that I have to unplug the battery for this, and I'll go over why that's BS later. And then what I'm going to do over here, see how this cable bends around? It's really, really confusing. It's a confusing little nightmarish mess. What I'm going to do here is, let me just make sure I get this in focus for you. Let's see, how much zoom do I get on this camera? How much zoom does $2,300 get me? That's a good amount of zoom, I think. Okay, let's get some focus going on here. Focus in the right section. Here we go. Now, there's a latch that has to come up. Don't rip the cable. Don't pull the PC board down all the way or you'll rip the cable. Remember, this is a video game. And if you rip it all the way down, you lose. So I go like this. Usually I'm not doing that at this angle, but, you know, I can't mount this camera on my head, so this is the best I can do. And then I gently pull the cable out. It's not going to want to come out, so I'm going to hold the PC board down, jimmy it a little bit, and bam. Now, the next important thing is going to be to make sure that that shit is not still taped over here. Because look, I'm pulling the PC board away, I'm pulling the screen away, whoops, I'm ripping the backlight flex. No, we're not ripping the backlight flex. Fuck that. If you rip the backlight flex, the Apple engineers win, and you don't want the Apple engineers to win. They're douchebags. So, we're gonna zoom back out. Gonna zoom back out. Okay, now we have to get this fucking screen out of the case. So, this is the other fun part here. So we're gonna put the machine like this. Now, the way I'd usually do this is I'm gonna pull up like right over here. So I keep this metal thing on. This metal bar on the bottom is glued to the back of the screen. Apple loves their glue. Apple. Okay. Now, see how I'm pulling upwards? It's not going to come out because it's glued on. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn on the JBC, but I'm not going to turn it on at a hot temperature. No 450 Celsius here. I'm going to put this to something like maybe 170 Celsius. I'm going to turn the air down to like 58%. I'm going to do this from far away. I'm going to be putting a tiny bit of pressure. The reason I'm putting this pressure, the reason I'm pulling like this, is because I don't want to rip it. I don't want to crack it. I want to put a tiny bit of pressure so that as the adhesive loosens, it's going to slowly come up on its own. The idea here is patience. Here you'll be able to tell if there's anything in your life that's been pissing you off or annoying you, because anything that's been pissing you off or annoying you is going to cause you to crack the screen and not have it come off in one piece. So if you are not at peace with yourself, you will not be able to remove this in one piece. But removing it in one piece is what you want. You don't want to be in a situation where you're removing hundreds of little pieces of cracked glass. The way that people destroy the back layers of the screen is that they're trying to remove the cracked glass with a tool, and they're touching it, and they repeatedly touch it, and the glass touches it, and as they're cleaning it, they're fucking it up. So the best way to not get anything on the back layers of the screen is to not fuck it up. It's just to not get any glass on it and to remove this in one piece. Now, what do I mean when I say back layers of the screen? What I mean when I say back layers of the screen is very simple. The rear layers of the screen on these models are the backlight diffuser. Now, in old laptop LCD panels, the idea is that you had the backlight, the diffuser so that the light was spread evenly, and the actual screen itself all in one piece. In this model, they're all glued together, and when I remove the LCD, the layers will still be there. So if you get anything on those pieces, you're screwed. This was never meant to be opened up by idiots in an office wearing, you know, gloves that cost 10 cents. This was meant to be designed and manufactured in some kind of professional, well, real professional manner. Not to knock myself there, but like the traditional definition of professional, you know, the ISO clean room and all that shit. Now what I do, once I lift it up, I don't want to screw myself and have this fall back down while I'm lifting the other side. So what I do at this point is I scrape up the adhesive. Let me just zoom in on the adhesive here. This is taking a lot longer than usual because I'm recording it, go figure. I'm going to just zoom in on this. All right. So check this. I'm going to grab the adhesive with the tweezer, and I'm going to rip it right off. Okay, I'm going to try and grab it with my faint hands. slowly go like this. So now I don't have to worry about the left side falling back down because it won't stick. You'll also note that one of those diffuser layers is trying to come up with it, and we're not going to let that happen. We're going to sell that thing a big GTFO, but that comes up in the next part. Now we're going to move over to the other side. Alrighty, let's get this in focus here. Okay, focus. Focus. There we go. Other side is now in focus. Alrighty. Kind of in focus, maybe sorta. See what I'm doing here? I'm lifting up this. Well, you can't. You can't see shit. Alright, let's see. Can I do it by this? So I'm going to lift up the screen a little bit like this. I'm going to still be pulling it from this middle tab. Pull it from the middle tab, like so. And I'm going to start heating the other side. Now, the other side is a bit more adhesive on it. I think that piece is a little larger. And the other side is always the one that's a pain in the ass to get off. So I'm going to up the temperature a tiny bit. I'm going to go up to 200 Celsius here. And the thing is, it's not really about the temperature you set. It's more about how far away you have the tool that's making the hot air. Because, I mean, I can do this with a heat gun if I want to. And there's no temperature control on that. There's, like, on and off. So we're going up and down, we're going up and down. Using a very conservative temperature of 200 Celsius here. I'm taking great care to not burn the webcam cable. That would not be nice, but I doubt I'm going to really do much with 200 Celsius unless I keep it there for a really long time. I know what you're thinking, put the camera on the other side, but I have nothing to put on the other side for the camera. Let's see, I can get a. Here we go. This is a bit of a better angle. Nothing to rest the camera on the other side. Do this. Maybe zoom out a tiny bit. Okay, there we go. That's a better angle. Not the way I would usually do this. So see, I'm pulling upwards on the, by from this metal bar. And the idea is that I should be pulling it with just a tiny bit of tension, just enough so that when the adhesive loosens, that it just comes off on its own. Because if it's coming off on its own gradually, I'm not going to have that issue where the screen cracks on its own. And I don't want this to crack. I want this to come off in one consolidated piece. So I'm going to take my time with it. And while I'm taking my time with it, the phone rings. Whoa, that surprised me. Somebody called that was actually happy. That never happens. That's how you can tell that somebody's probably not from New York, when they call and they're happy. That they're not, they weren't born here. I always try to answer the phone happy, like, hello. What can I do for you? In happy tone. Because people kind of tend to mirror how your emotions or how you act. Even pissed off people can get, can be made to smile sometimes with a little bit of, like, a smile on your face or just a positive attitude. Sometimes it doesn't work. Some people are just miserable pricks and. But yeah, that's okay. We're getting there. Come on. You're not using the temperature I'm used to. Yeah, I should just go higher. Here we go. 230. Up, down. You also don't want to burn the back layers. Too little heat, and you'll crack the screen because it won't come off. And too much heat, and you'll burn the back layers. And again, remember, this is like a game, like that shitty little ET game. From the early 80s, so easy to lose. If you do anything wrong, you do not get, you do not pass go, do not collect $200. Do not make any money. So it's important to do this properly. Now what I usually do with the heat gun is I actually hold it up really far away. That heats more of the whole area. I should just grab the heat gun, but I think I'm out of outlets here. No, nice try. Okay, less tension. This is actually better done with a heat gun than it is with this. Okay, it's starting to come off. It's the same principle of what I did on the other side. It just takes longer and is more of a pain in the ass on this side. Now, one of the things I like to do, once I see that a lot of it has come off, is actually start removing the adhesive. So see how much of it came off? See, I'm going to take this adhesive and pull it off. Because if I can rip the adhesive off, then, you know, it's not going to stick back down. And sometimes I get lucky and I could rip the adhesive off all the way up. Sometimes, no such luck. Okay. Okay, so I didn't get it off all in one piece. I was very close to it. But that doesn't mean that I lose the game. So check it out. Take these tweezers, and I'm not trying to grab the glass. I'm actually trying to grab the adhesive. Because remember, the glass is stuck to the adhesive, right? So if I can just grab the adhesive up all in one piece, I have nothing to worry about. Sometimes I win and I get it all off in one piece, and sometimes I don't win. But just because I lost this one level doesn't mean that I lost the game. See, I'm trying to get it off by the adhesive. I want the glass to stick to the adhesive, not run away and get on the layers. Okay, so so far, just about all the glass has come off with the adhesive, which means that I haven't gotten any of it on my screen. Good stuff here. And also, with the old adhesive, I don't reuse this old shit. Because here's the reason I don't reuse the old adhesive, because there's different schools of thought on this. The old adhesive itself can have little cracked pieces of glass on it. And if you put the new screen on top of the old adhesive and there's a little piece of glass on it that you can't see, it may crack on its own. The screen itself may crack because, you don't want this sitting on an old piece of glass, right? So this is the screen. Now, if I put this screen on top of tape that has cracked glass from the old screen on it, and I push... Look, so this is what's going to happen when you push on the screen. You don't want this stuff happening. It's very fragile. This is a really fragile screen. You don't want any cracking to occur. Now, so I'm not going to reuse the old shit. Not reusing the old adhesive. There's too high a risk of it having something on there. And again, the last thing you want in the world is for a customer to come back to you and say, the screen cracked on its own. I didn't do anything. And the reason that I can be 100% sure that when somebody says that they didn't do anything and the screen cracked on its own, you know why I can, why I have such confidence that they're bullshitting, that it's, you know, just not true? It's because I didn't leave any of the original adhesive, and I go over this thing with a fine tooth comb to make sure that there's no glass left on there. Now, I'm going to use this clear tape, this red tape over here. The reason that I use this clear stuff instead of the black stuff is because user error, you know, is a big risk here. There's big risk for user error. So while I'm putting this stuff on, right, it's very easy to put it on and perhaps misalign it a tiny bit so that this is in the range of the screen. Now, if you look really closely at almost any LCD screen in existence, you'll notice that there's a little black border around the screen. And that black border is actually a little bit of a safety net for me here because I may get the adhesive inside the black border. God forbid that it goes a tiny bit beyond the black border and it's actually in the visible range. If the tape itself is clear, it's not going to be as noticeable as if the tape is black. In an ideal world, you wouldn't get any tape in the visible range. But again, I don't live in an ideal world, and I certainly don't have ideal hands, so I do what I can with what I have. And the clear tape helps me to avoid looking like a fucking idiot. So I put it all the way around. Again, I don't want the screen falling out of the frame. I don't want people saying that the screen's going to fall out of the frame. And I'm not reusing any of the original tape because I don't want there to be even a 1% possibility of any glass being in here. If there's glass in here, then I'm screwed. And I have a... If I screw up and I see that I screwed something up, I will give people a new screen for free. But, and the reason that I just have a great confidence that the screen didn't crack on its own is because I put it in, taking this extra time to not reuse the old adhesive. So, do this. Okay, did I put the tape on the best? No. Okay, sometimes the tape may not make the best path. So it doesn't go on perfectly straight, so I'm just going to correct it a little bit. Didn't go on all the way straight. That's fine. Again, you shouldn't touch this even with gloves, but just I wear the gloves just in case. Don't want to get any fingerprints on there. You can't clean it. If you take a microfiber cloth to try and clean stuff off of this, it will just get worse. There's no cleaning this. There's nothing you can do. If you get a mark on this, you're done. Don't even try. Okay. Now, at this point, I'm going to turn it around. Now, there is the small possibility of there being dust under there. So what I do is I'm going to get the compressed air. I'm not going to seal that part with tape just yet. So I'm just going to walk up and get the compressed air, turn it on, and be right back. Okay, so for those of you with an air compressor, small nozzle, I would say somewhere around 50 PSI is the max you want to be at. I usually use it at 25. The only reason I'm using it at 50 to 60 is because I have some degree of control based on how hard I press this. So I'm just going to do a little bit of this. Now, before I apply the last layer of tape, I'm going to put the screen on because I can't see the dust as is. It's hard to see the dust on this background. So when you're replacing a screen on, let's say, a unibody, let's say you're just replacing the glass and not the LCD, the LCD itself is black, so it's easier to see the dust, if there's any dust present, without any type of illumination. But since this is clear, seeing the dust, which is usually a light color of gray, is very, very difficult without the illumination. So what I have to do now is I have to remove this little bar from the bottom of the screen. I'm going to put the screen down here. I'm going to plug it in just so that I can get the brightness to go up on here so that I can see the light turn on so I can see the dust. But I'm not going to put the screen in yet because I may have to blow some of the dust out from the side. So what I'm going to do here, I'm going to heat this thing up. Here, I don't really care about damaging the old screen because the old screen is a broken old piece of shit that's going to go in the e-waste container anyway. So I'm just going to put the temperature ridiculously high on the JBC, the air ridiculously high on the JBC, and Bernie Bernie. Burn, 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 burn. Burn this. This little metal bar is important. Okay. The whole idea behind the metal bar is that it's going to hide the individual LEDs in the bottom, because if you don't have this bar there to cover the individual LEDs, you'll see a little pattern at the bottom. Guess how I learned that one. Alright, didn't heat it enough. Worst cameraman ever. Alright, comes off nice. It's going to have adhesive on it. And the same rule applies. When remove it, don't reuse the old adhesive. Don't be lazy. This is going to fuck you. This is going to fuck you very hard. If there's any glass on that old adhesive, and again, sometimes you can't see it. You may look at it really quickly and say, I don't see any glass on it. I can reuse it. You don't see it now. But when somebody comes back 6 months later and says, my screen cracked on it, and you take it apart, and you look right where the crack is, and you see that there's a big pink piece of glass, you know, the few seconds it saved you is not going to be worth it. So I'm going to put this on, and then I'm going to get the new screen. And turn off the JBC now. There's no need for it. Okay, now we're going to go back to those screws, those lovely screws that Apple covered in the fucking tape from earlier in the video. Let's just go over here. Do this. I'm going to place this down here. Place this down here. Screw it in. Nothing super complicated on this part. This takes so much longer on camera. I have to keep looking at the screen and making sure that I'm not hiding stuff, that you can see everything. Once you get really good at this, I would say 17 to 20 minutes should be the amount of time it takes you. If you're doing it for the first time, expect it to take 1 to 2 hours. My first video was somewhere around the hour to hour and a half mark, I believe. Oh, wrong screw. But the silver screws with the tape are the ones that are going into this bracket. Also realize, the large screw, there's five screws down here. The large one goes all the way on the left and all the way on the right, and the regular size screws go in the three middle screw holes. Remember, you got to have a different size screw for everything. We're Apple. We think different. You got to have a different size for every single fucking screw for no good reason. Think different. Don't even think at all. Okay, so we have the new screen here. So the first thing I'm going to have to do is take this tape. Do the same thing. I'm going to put a layer of new adhesive over here, not the old shit. And that's going to stick the screen over here. Again, I prefer to use the clear tape here rather than the black tape, just because, you know, if you screw something up, I'm not saying you should screw something up, but if you do, because you're human, it won't show up as badly as it will if you use black tape. If you use black tape, then you get a really obvious reminder that somebody screwed something up, and that's no fun. So we take this, we do this, and we peel it, and we're good. So, now the fun part is going to be plugging in the connectors. This is the part that sucks. This is the part that sucks. Okay. So we do this. We are going to... this is going to be hard to get a good camera angle on. Let's see if I twist it around here. Okay, we do this. Here we go. How about now? All right, so the first cable that I plug in here is going to be the LCD cable. This is not an LVDS cable. It's an EDP DisplayPort cable. So EDP. Display port. Now, I'm not saying this to be pedantic. I'm saying it because it genuinely matters for troubleshooting purposes. Yeah, this is hard. I gotta do it so that you can see it. This is so easy when I don't have to care about whether you can see. Because I'm used to... Here we go. Now, the way LVDS works is what you're seeing when you have an LVDS signal, you have a couple of LVDS signaling lines, and you're seeing the difference between the lines. Whereas in EDP, it's just sending a signal. It's not the difference between the lines. It's just data. The reason this matters is because it's impossible for you to have a distorted picture on the screen because of a DisplayPort cable. So if you see a distorted image on the screen, it is impossible for it to be the cable. If you see the colors look fucked up on a machine that uses DisplayPort, it is not possible for it to be the cable because of how the protocol works. And I know that the filming here sucks. I don't have an assistant, so this is what you get. I got to finish this before the person calls screaming why it isn't done yet. So the point here is... It is possible, but very rare, very, very rare, for it to be the cable. When you see funny colors or shit on the screen, it's very rare, but it is possible for it to be the cable with LVDS. It's impossible with DisplayPort. It's an all-or-nothing protocol. It's either there or it's not. Yeah, I just, you know, recently got a lovely... There's one person that we told it was definitely the screen to, and we explained this entire thing, and we looked at him, and we go, "Do you want to repair it?" And he says yes. And then when we fix it at the price that we told him, he's like, "Why did you fix it? I didn't approve." There's a nice like 15,000 page Yelp review on that, 1-star review on that whole thing. But it's very important here because, again, a lot of this, if you can explain it to your customers, it makes it easy. Sometimes you're going to have people that just look to screw you over anyway and just, you know, just try to be a pain in the ass. But if you can explain the real technology behind the reasoning behind why something is to your customers, they're less likely to believe that you're just trying to screw them over. So that's why it's good to know some of this stuff. All right, so there's no way I can really get a good camera angle on this. I can try, but it sucks. Yeah, so plugging this cable in is a royal pain in the ass. I want you to understand that it has a fold in it, though. Can you see the fold? Probably can't. Let's see if I can turn the light on here, if that even makes any difference. Does the light make a difference? Nope. Oh, well. So, this cable here has a fold. I want you to understand the fold of the cable. It's going down and then around. into there. And if it's folded, if it's plugged in upside down, this shit won't work. That's very important. If you plug that cable in upside down, you'll get no backlight. Now, you can measure for backlight on backlight output, and you'll see something like 49 to 50 volts. And that's how you can tell that you plug the cable in upside down. The reason behind that is that when there's no load on a boost circuit, if it's on, you're going to see a higher voltage than you would if there was a load. So let's say we're trying to make 27 volts for the screen. That circuit is being told we want to get somewhere around 27 volts to our LCD screen. And the screen is not plugged in. There's no load. So it's used to making 27 volts with a specific load. But if there's no load and it's being told to make 27 volts and it's expecting the load of a screen or a backlight, then you're going to see something like 49 volts. So that's a really easy way to tell that somebody didn't plug in that cable or that they plugged it in upside down when the bottom of the machine is off without having to take the bezel off and all that crap. If I see 48 or 49 volts on backlight, I know that it was plugged in upside down. Makes life a lot easier. All right, so now I'm going to turn it on with the screen not in the machine. I'm going to hold down Option. The reason I'm holding down Option is because I don't want to boot into an operating system and then turn it off while it's in the operating system and screw up the guy's operating system. So I'm holding, and this also allows me to see a picture. Also, see this? I used to get a lot of morons when I was selling screens on the internet who would say, "Look, there's dead pixels. Look at the dead pixels." Like they would totally ignore the fact that the dead pixels are it's a screen protector. Do you really think that the dead pixels on the screen are going to say 505 OTL 3-0121? Like no. Like, what a coincidence that the dead pixels just so happen to be a fucking coherent expression. They're not dead pixels, so please don't torture your panel vendor. So I see a little bit of dust over here, which is not going to show up on the camera because it's far too bright. But yeah, I see the dust. I'm going to peel back. Even if you don't have gloves, you can do this without getting marks on if you touch by the corner. Don't touch this by the middle of it. Don't touch this part of it. You'll screw it up. If you're going to touch it from the edge, from the corner. I blow away the dust that I see. I'm glad that I didn't seal it before, because if I did, I would have sealed that little piece in. And now I can lay down my adhesive. And I lay down the roll of it, and bam. Again, it's good to use that clear adhesive, because even if you screw up, you can save yourself. Now, do this. Oh my god. Okay, so I've got my adhesive down. I'm gonna just peel this part off. And then we're very close to getting to the most miserable part of this entire job. So I'm gonna just get my adhesive off here. Yeah, push it down. Break it off. There we go. Now blow away any of the dust that may be on the top layer. Don't use too much pressure. Resting the compressed air on my leg just in case I need to use it again.
Yeah.
Okay, so remove the first screen protector now. Also, I do this. You know why I'm going to do this? When the dust falls, because most of the time dust is falling like this, it's not going to land on my screen. Now I'm going to rip the protector off. This is much harder with gloves than without gloves, and it's also considerably harder when people don't stop calling. Ah, thank God that person rang. It rang once, and then they hung up. Oh, no such luck for me. Never mind. Be right back. There was the same person that called 3 hours ago that I said no to on something being cheaper, and they called again just to try again. Good thing, very good thing that Free PBX is a blacklist. I use that feature all the time. I mean all the time. All right, so back to where we were before being interrupted. It's going to take off the first screen protector. There's no dust here. We're nice, and here we go. And bam, now. You're going to have to make sure that it's on there evenly. So there's going to be these. I wish I could show it to you on camera, but I just can't because I'll screw it up if I show you while I'm actually doing it. Okay, let's see. Can I get the zoom? Okay, now I just got to try and focus this. There's going to be these little L-shaped indents in the corner. You probably can't see that. Sorry. It's a different color than the rest. So it's up in there, and that kind of shows you where to put the screen. If you don't follow those indents, then the screen will go in lopsided and you'll be screwed. Another thing is to make sure that your adhesive tape does not go over the light sensor or over the webcam, or else, you know, the keyboard will start turning on even when you're in a well-lit room. And so I push the screen in like this. Oh, I have to zoom out so you can see that. Push the screen in like this. Bam. I rip off this part of the screen protector. Actually, I'll rip that off in a second. Now, for the outside, I use this black tape because I don't have a wide version of the clear tape here. I usually do. For some reason, I don't now. And also, I don't, you know, I don't have to worry about this potentially going into a visible area. So, just nothing nuts here. Now, the one part that really sucks, that I hate, is removing the old adhesive from the old thing. That's just one of those Foxconn jobs that I really, I don't want to do. Like, that belongs to somebody who makes a dollar an hour in China. I hate that stuff. And if you want to make fun of me for saying a dollar an hour in China or $2 an hour in China or stuff like that, don't be mad at me. Be mad at yourself for buying the products that are designed in that fashion. Yeah. Okay. Take you off. Make sure the black tape is rolled on the inside. You can use a scissor instead of your fingernail. I'm using my fingernail because the scissors are up front. And I know that as soon as I go up front, the phone will ring and I'll have to sit back down or something will happen. So I like using my fingernail to cut this stuff. Okay, we get a nice, good adhesive all around. Don't use super glue. Super glue has its uses. It really does. There was this one person, I think Ali Kazmucha or something, that said on this thread many years ago, you shouldn't be in this business if you use super glue, or you don't deserve a job. And it's like, you know, all I can think to people who say that stuff is, you know, go fuck yourself. Seriously. Because you can't tell me that there's no use for something ever. And that I shouldn't be here if I use that. Because there are times where super glue actually is a legitimate tool that does make sense. The problem is that 99% of the time, and this is one of those, 99% of the time, super glue is bullshit. It's being used by people who don't have tape, but they have super glue somewhere in their kitchen drawer. And this is not where you use super glue. The thing is, the super glue doesn't cure fast enough, and it also, it's not flat. So you have all these little glotches and globules and garbage, and, you know, it doesn't really stick. Like, as soon as you stick something to this, it's stuck instantly. It doesn't bulge out because it's a thin tape. The super glue bulges everywhere. It's hard to remove. The fumes it emits when you heat it to try to remove it are awful. It's just really bad shit. So don't use super glue here. Does super glue have a use? Absolutely. It has many uses, and I've used it for this job. For, like, the, you know, the field of laptop or portable device repair. It does have a use, but You should be experienced by the time you're using super glue. Don't just, like, take it out because you don't have any experience and that's all you have in your kitchen cupboard. All right. Now I go over any of the little spots that I missed. Yeah, I'm one of those freaks that likes to have the adhesive everywhere. I know. Call me crazy. I like bezels that don't pop off. I want this bezel to be sitting here 25 years from now. I want this person to be able to travel to the equator and for the CPU to overheat and the computer to die and of being burned and for this bezel to still not have ever come off the computer. Also, here we go. That would make me happy. So I go over all the little regions where I may have missed it. It's not really necessary when you have adhesive that's this strong to begin with, but just any area that I may have screwed up. I like having bezels that are OCD proof. Like, I dare somebody to spend 30 minutes staring at the fucking bezel, correcting my work, going, I don't want to pay because that doesn't look the way it did out of the box. Fuck you. It will look fucking better than it did out of the box. I also don't grab the scissors often because I lose them constantly, and the receptionist will kill me if I keep losing her scissors. Alright. So at this point, we are set. Nice, uneven set of adhesive. Looks exactly like something I would do. Well, it's gonna work, so. Alright, so now for the least favorite part of this whole process, the bullshit part. The one that... The bullshit part is going to be removing the adhesive from the old bezel. Ah, oh, this part sucks. And again, but you have to. Don't put this back on there with the old adhesive. That's such a shit thing to do. You may not get all of it. Now, there's two adhesives on here. There's the black one, which just peels off like this. Which is great. I like this. This is nice stuff. I enjoy it. I think it should be used more often. And then there's the clear stuff, like this, which is going to make you want to kill yourself. Let's get a better view. Man, this stuff sucks balls. Oh, this just... There's no other way to say it. This just... This part just sucks. This part just sucks. Now, in an ideal world, you'd be able to get it off in one piece, which is what I'm trying to do. Make it nice and slowly. But see, it kind of strips off at points like over here. And it's just horseshit. All the fucking adhesives to use, Apple. Why? If you leave a layer on that's like really, really, really thin, it's not going to affect anything. But you don't want to leave this huge bullshit on. Because I've seen people leave all this old crap on and glue this on top of it. And that's bullshit. That's genuinely bullshit. That's just being lazy. I'm not going to remove every single little inch of it because that would be a couple of hours of time there. And that's not going to make any fucking difference. I mean, literally no discernible difference, no noticeable difference, no measurable difference. So that's a layer. You try to get it off in one piece. Peel at one end. Really get all the way under it. Make sure you're all the way under it. And then just pull, and it will come off. See how nice I am? I don't want the receptionist to have too much work when she comes in tomorrow, so. Usually I do all the boards, the salesperson deals with all the douchebags, and she does all the screens, keyboards, reassembly, stuff like that. It's a nice, well-knit team. But it would be a shitty thing of me to sit here because I have no boards to fix today and do nothing just because, quote-unquote, this is not my job. Even as a business owner, it's kind of a shitty thing to do. One of the things you'll notice is that the people, like I've had a lot of people over the years, and there are a lot of people that have said this is not my job, and oftentimes the people who said this is not my job were actually correct in that something was not their job. But all the people that I've had that have stuck around, the people that are like still are employed, were the people that never use those words, this is not my job. Just something to think about if you work at another company and you want to know why you haven't why you haven't made it where you want to yet. Because here, admittedly, at this type of company, it's not exactly like there's a bunch of room for advancement. You know, it's a small neighborhood repair store. But I mean, the same thing applies to a lot of other businesses. I mean, if I'm really passionate about the company that I work for, there is no such thing as this is not my job. That really, there's nothing that demoralizes a company or its employees or its management faster than just hearing people say that's not my job. And sometimes you may be right. Sometimes you may be right. You're dealing with a lazy prick that's not doing their job, so you're saying it's not my job to do something. But if you see that everybody else is busy and you have shit to do, I mean, a little bit just goes a long way. It comes back to you later. So. You know, the more you say this is not my job, the more you may notice down the road when that you don't have a job. You know, I suck at this. I suck ass at this job. I hate it. I'm not going to just not do it, sit here and twiddle my dick all day, and leave a bunch of stuff for the person who comes in tomorrow. That's mean. It's demoralizing. Okay. So. My cheap ass glove broke. Oh well. That's its way of saying you've cleaned enough adhesive. Thank you, glove, for giving me a little bit of time off. Okay, now it's time to finish this. I'm not going to boot it up because if I do, you'll get to see the person's name and you'll internet stalk them. I've got some... This has happened before. So, just going to get that little... fucking... Yeah, this is why the thumb in my glove broke. I try to limit how much I touch computers that come in with my bare hands as much as possible now because they've just been getting dirtier and dirtier. I had one get sent here with some pieces of Fig Newton stuck all over it and inside of it. I was curious why the hell this one slot had ants crawling all over it. I opened the computer, it's filled with fucking Fig Newtons. There's ants inside the optical drive. There was an ant inside the sealed part of the optical drive. It stunned me. Like the nasty shit that people put inside these. So I don't touch this stuff anymore with my bare hands just because it's too fucking disgusting. You know, it's worth it for me to buy gloves. So make sure the webcam is aligned. Make sure the corner is aligned. Don't put the bezel on top of the rubber trim. That's no good. So you're just going to push it down with your fingers a little bit. Not too much. And then after that, I just use a paper towel and alcohol, Windex, you know, something like that. I like alcohol because it evaporates quickly and I move back and forth. The reason I use the alcohol is because it just takes away some of the friction and allows me to push down harder, and it also cleans off the bezel in case I got anything on it while I was working. Do this. And I'm just about done here. This is it for today. And okay, again, the bottom, this is the part that really matters, because the part that kills me, the part that will drive me nuts is when I see a gap between the bezel and the bezel and the frame. It drives me nuts. So that's why I work so hard on putting the adhesive on properly, removing the old adhesive, but above all, also putting that extra row of the thin adhesive on the top. Because if I don't put that extra row of thin adhesive on the top, it will move back, and there's just nothing nastier to me and no sign of shitty work more than having a gap over there. Sometimes the way they broke it, you may have a gap over there, but very rarely. And that's about that for today. So, there we go. That is how I replace the screen on a MacBook Air. Slightly different than how I did it many years ago. Hopefully better than how I did it many years ago. And yeah, that's that. If you have any questions, feel free to put them in the comments. And yeah, that's it. Last thing I forgot to say. When you're done with this whole process here, you're going to want to calibrate the screen. So what you're going to want to do is log in. I know you're going to have to get the password from them. They may not trust you. If they don't trust you with the password, that's totally fine. Tell them they can calibrate their own screen, and that if they want to complain about it looking bluish or purplish, that's on them. You're going to go to the upper left corner, Apple, the little Apple icon, System Preferences, Display. You go to the Color tab, and then you're going to choose Color LCD. There may be multiple listings of Color LCD. Choose the one that looks like it makes the most sense, the one that looks the least like crap, and the one that looks the way it did before the screen broke. Sometimes you'll have to adjust the calibration or else it'll look funny, and you're going to have people that go, I don't want this. It doesn't look right. It looks bluer than it is before, particularly if you're a mail-in business that doesn't have the opportunity to ask the customer for their password, particularly if you're a mail-in business that doesn't have the opportunity to interact with the customer at the time that they pick it up. And since you're not there to interact with them, they may start becoming more and more paranoid, think you screwed them over, think you gave them a knockoff screen, blah, 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 blah. Just include a little note in the box that says, you didn't provide a password, and we have to calibrate the screen. Here's what you can do to calibrate it on your own so that you don't wind up with some one-star review because, you know, you installed a knockoff screen. If you're watching this and you're not a repair store and you are an end customer, realize that there are no knockoff screens. With iPhones, there are knockoff screens everywhere. With iPads, there are knockoff screens everywhere. With this, there is no such thing as a knockoff screen. Nobody is advanced enough to produce a knockoff screen for this. It's impossible. It's not even in the question. If the colors look funny, it means that it's either broken or that it's not calibrated. So just remember to calibrate it at the end, and you'll be good. You'll be set. Hopefully this has been informative. Have a nice day.